Hey guys. Okay, for those of you who haven't yet been to office hours, welcome to my office, or at least a little bit of it that you can see from the camera. So this is me kind of following on from Wednesday's class, and I want to record these versions in lieu of both Friday and Monday's class. So if things go well, this will just be a relatively long video that's both the Friday and the Monday one mixed. All right, cool. So I know when we go through this clinical thing, we have these groups of disorders, and it can be a little confusing. So I'll touch base with that every now and then. So far we talked about the somatoform disorders, which tended to be more about feelings of physical health, problems with physical health. We've talked about the dissociative disorders, which were those things like multiple personality disorder, where we have this somehow split in a person. And we've begun talking about now emotional disorders. And under emotional disorders, we first talked about depression itself. And then we got into this notion of bipolar disorder, where depression gets mixed with these episodes of mania. And so bipolar, two poles. So people go really, really low, and then they go really, really high. And the high is the mania. And they actually feel great. And so that last thing that I did, and I'm not going to expose you to it again, but the link is there in the slides, was to throw this guy up that was experiencing a manic episode. And he knew he was experiencing a manic episode, and he decided to film himself and to try to give you a sense of what that manic episode feels like for him. And so, yeah, he's a little crass. Some of his words are not the best words, but I think he does give you that feel of what mania feels like. And again, it looks like a good thing, sort of. It looks like it feels good, and it does feel good, according to people. However, it feels too good. It makes people feel too immortal, for lack of a better word. They can do anything and they want to do everything. And again, one of the major problems is there are often major consequences that come from the manic episode. So, for example, I mentioned Justin Trudeau's mom going through this, Margaret Trudeau. And you can imagine when you're the prime minister's wife and you show up backstage of a rock concert for a band that was generally considered to be a pretty out there band, let's say. There's consequences, right? Your husband has to explain to the public what's going on. And so at some point you come out of your mania and you think, oh my goodness, what have I done? And that's when you swing back down to the depression. And so the mania in the end becomes just another thing to kind of push people into depression. Okay, so that's the bipolar. Now, if we kind of follow this depression theme or this emotional disorder theme a little bit more, you can get into these patterns. And so we're first going to talk about the cognitive causes. And there can be patterns of thought that can result in a string of self-fulfilling prophecies, as I say here. Imagine somebody who just assumes everything's going to go wrong. And so they go into some situation, like let's say your friend sets you up with somebody, and they think this could be somebody that'll make you happy. It's nice how friends do that, right? And so I want you to meet them, and you're thinking going into this person is gonna like me. They're not gonna like the clothes I picked out. They're gonna think I'm ugly. They're gonna think I'm boring. This isn't gonna work. And imagine going into a meeting with that sort of mindset, how everything's gonna turn out horrible. And quite often, just the fact that you think that can make it true. So if you come in, you're probably, first of all, not going to look confident. You're probably not going to be smiling. You're probably not going to be socially bubbly. You're going to be like, go ahead, hate me. Come on. I'm ready for you to hate me. And nobody likes that, right? That's not an attractive way to be. And so it may not go well. And therefore, you can get into this self-fulfilling prophecies where if you think everything is going to go badly, it often does. And that can feed. See, I knew it. I'm right. I have no control. Everything always turns out wrong. So you can get into those cycles. We also do know for sure that if you ask a depressed person, someone suffering from depression, about their day and what happened, they will tend to remember the negative things that happened well. They won't remember the positive things so well, and they will also overblow the negatives. Things that were not really a big deal. I came in a little late to class, and the professor looked at me when I walked in, and he hates me, and I know he's angry because I interrupted him, and he's probably going to do everything he can to make sure I fail the course and blah blah. It's like, well, wait a minute, just because he looked at you when you walked in, you assume all these things, and that is what they do. They pack in all this negativity to a what might be just a minor negative event, if negative at all. They do often, as suggested here, blame the situation on themselves. They literally think, I am inadequate. I am not a good person. I am helpless. I am hopeless. I am not the kind of person I'd want to be around. And so they're really taking, that's that simultaneous mix of, I have no ability to affect the situation. So that helplessness, which I call an external locus of control, they think things just happen. They can't control it. And yet still, when bad things happen, they think it's their fault. So they're kind of double whammying themselves, feeling like they have no control, and yet every bad thing is because of who I am. It's not necessarily that they caused the bad thing to happen, but it happened because of who they are. Okay. Now, obviously, if this person has some negatives in their life, that just feeds into everything, right? Because it gives them something to overblow. It gives them something to think about a lot. Now, here's the positive side of this. Because we know the way they think about the world feeds in and causes a bit of a feedback loop that makes the depression deeper. If we can change the way they think about the world, if we can teach them new techniques, new cognitive approaches, then we might be able to prevent this negative spiral. We might be able to actually have them see a small negative as a small negative. So we're going to talk about that quite a bit when we get into the therapeutic section. So let me be clear about that, because I don't know if I have. What I'm doing right now is just sort of introducing you to the disorders. And then in the next section, we're going to talk, in the next chapter, we're going to talk about how we actually treat these disorders. So depression will be one of them, and I'll give you a taste of that now. Because here's something you could use. If you feel like sometimes you are prone to depressive mental states, one of the things you could do, for example, is at the end of every day, find your smartphone, find this puppy, find the little note section here, write yourself a new note, and in that new note, write down any good thing that happened during the day. Only a good thing. Don't write any of the bad things down, but write down any of the good things that happen. If you do this at the end of every day, and if you start getting in the habit of knowing, okay, at the end of today, I have to make note of all the good things that happened, then what you're going to do is, as you go through the day, you'll start to notice the good things. Oh, that was a good thing. I'm going to have to put that in my notes tonight. And so we can try to reverse this process. We can try to get people to attend more to the positive things, and then at the end of the day, elaborate more on the positive things and try to get those positive events into their mind as well, crowding out the negative thoughts and ideas. And so that's one simple example of how you could strategically try to alter the way the person is interacting and thinking about the world. And there's a lot of studies, by the way, that show that this truly does help. Okay, so we'll get more details on that, but that's a taste. Okay, back to sort of what causes depression. So we know those cognitive things are at play. We do know there's genetic causes for all of these mood disorders. It's certainly the case that the likelihood of having one is much higher. For example, so in the twin studies, let's do the twin studies. If you're an identical twin, if your twin is depressed, the likelihood that you'll suffer depression is very high, much higher than it would be if it were fraternal twins. So that common genetics between you and the identical twin seems to lead to, very high likelihood that you will both develop this disorder. And so that's suggesting that the genetics are playing a role, that they're having some sort of thing. So there's something about your genetic inheritance that can make you more prone to depression. When we get to more of the physiological levels, we know there are biochemical factors. So we know that things like low levels of norepinephrine and serotonin. So those are two neurotransmitters in the brain are associated with depression. So people who are depressed have lower levels of these. And we do know that if we give them drugs that increase the level of these neurotransmitters, especially serotonin is often used, then we can actually make the person feel happier and feel better. If you think of the street drug ecstasy or Molly, as some people call it, or if you think of the prescribed drug Prozac, you might have heard of Prozac. Those work by blocking the reuptake of serotonin. So what that means is when your brain releases serotonin, it sticks around longer. And so it's like it's having a bigger effect. And when that happens, you feel happy. You feel positive. You're in a really good mindset. The classic thing with, why is it called ecstasy? It was called ecstasy because it made people feel really, really happy. They felt ecstatic when they took it. So certainly we know there's this link. It's always tricky though to, like I use this example sometimes where I say, you know, it's not like a car. You can't just top up the level of serotonin and everything's fine. The brain is very reactive. And so it could be, for example, the negative thinking that results in less serotonin. And maybe if they were getting more positive thoughts and focusing on positives, that might result in a natural release of more serotonin, for example. And so mind and physiology interact. It's a complex machine we're talking about with the brain. We'll talk about that more when we talk about drug treatments as well. By the way, I mentioned this as well, just about all, I mentioned it with depression that often sleep, you see weird sleep patterns. That's very common. There's this nice notion called Zeitgeber's, life-changing stressors and seasonal affective disorders. Light plays an important role in affecting our mood. So you guys know probably about SAD, seasonal affective disorder. When there's less sunlight in the winter, there's fewer hours of light, people tend to feel sad. They tend to feel more depressed. There are things, these Zeitgebers, that react to light and kind of put our minds into certain cycles, biorhythms, as it were. There's a fancier word for it that I'm blocking on it right now. At any rate, our whole body goes through these regular rhythms that determine when we're alert and how we feel and all these kinds of things, and they all lock on to light. And so sometimes when you get those messed up, it can affect your mood in pretty strong ways. And that's why one of the treatments for mood disorders is just getting a good sun lamp and exposing yourself to light, especially if you do it in a cyclical, like at a certain time every day and the first thing in the morning, give yourself a good light thing. It can make you feel a lot better. I mentioned here life-changing stressors. This is often connected with depression, but not always. Depression is very, very ubiquitous. It's everywhere. It comes in many forms. But one certainly does follow. If there's something dramatic happens in your life, that can often trigger depression. There. And this other thing that I know the women in this class hate me. I'm just trying to prepare you. I'm trying to make you understand. What we're showing here are just incidents of these various disorders, bipolar 1 and 2, major depressive disorder. And what you see is that in the period, just so we're comparing a person when they're pregnant, when they're expecting to give birth, versus the postpartum, the post-birth period. In the red bars. And what you see is just any hint of issue is it's almost doubled, almost more than double. So during this period after giving birth, it is extremely common for women to feel depressed. And at one level, that sounds like a negative thing. Why is Jordan just keep making us scared to have babies? That isn't really what I'm trying to do. What I'm trying to do is make you realize that should you have a baby and should you feel like there's something wrong with you because everyone else is so happy and excited about your baby, but you're not. you feel really sad, you feel really helpless, you feel really alone, you feel really sad, all those things linked to depression that we talked about, that's what you're feeling. And society has told you you shouldn't. You're supposed to be ecstatic. You got this new baby. You should be the happiest person, but you don't feel happy. And so what I'm trying to tell you is this is extremely normal. When I go back here and say life-changing stressors, having a baby changes a woman's life in an extreme way, and it changes her life in a way that tends to make her more socially isolated, takes her out of her social networks, and puts her in the home with the baby who needs her constantly. And so many mothers feel alone, they feel bored, they feel trapped to some extent by the baby, and they feel depressed. So again, all of this to say, this is very, very common. It passes, especially once the baby becomes a lot more socially receptive, because in those early periods, it's not. And so the biggest reason I keep hammering this home to you guys is just, you know, when you're there, when you feel it, just know it's common and know you're not the only one, and know that sort of is part of the process, and know that it will get better. That's the real important part. All right. Cool. That's it for emotional disorders. So rather than just stop there, I am going to launch into the next one, which I have somewhere here. Yeah. And we'll switch gears again. Oh, 21st Century Schizoid Man, King Crimson. This is a great song. I should play it anyway, but I won't. But it's my schizophrenia song. We will keep changing gears pretty dramatically, and this is one of the pretty dramatic changes of gears. Schizophrenia is a major category of mental disorder, and it's kind of distinct from some of the things we've been talking about. Like if you have a mood disorder, if you have depression, or even obsessive compulsive disorder, for example, you know that you're feeling something and you don't like it. And it feels like abnormal to you. You feel like not everyone feels like you do, and you wish you felt like other people do. When we get into things like schizophrenia, that gets a little more confusing. The person does not always know that they have an issue, and that makes it really hard to treat. So let's just jump into this a little bit. The first thing to note is that schizophrenia is very common. So this is showing the relative prevalence of schizophrenia on the top compared to things like, for example, Alzheimer's disease. So we think of Alzheimer's disease as a major, major issue that our society is facing, and it is. You know, this says like 2% of the population, two times, not 2%. A lot of the population have Alzheimer's disease or have been affected by it, but there's twice as many people affected by schizophrenia as Alzheimer's disease. Now, we talk about Alzheimer's disease, if our mother has it, or if our, you know, we know people who have it. We talk about that, we share information, and we share understanding. Sometimes people don't talk about schizophrenia as much, and so it can seem less dominant than it is. But next to perhaps depression, it's very kind of common. So about 1% of Canadians, 1 out of 100, have schizophrenia. All right, so it's not a single thing, as I highlight up in the top here. It's actually a grouping. We see a number of different, maybe variants of schizophrenia, and even those variants tend to be kind of messy as we talk about it. They do tend to have these disorders of thought, perception, and emotion, and they are often characterized by bizarre behavior, stuff that makes us go, and social withdrawal. Okay, so these people become sort of socially isolated in some way. I want to highlight, going back to dissociative disorders, that schizophrenia, schizo, actually means to cut, to break, schism, right, to split something. Phrenia is mind, schizophrenia means split mind. But it doesn't mean it like dissociative disorder does. It should actually be broken mind, not split mind, more like shattered mind. That's a little extreme. But what they meant when they came up with split mind wasn't multiple personality. It wasn't like we have two minds now. What they meant was more like the mind isn't working right. Things are getting messed up. So schizophrenia, the schizophrenic person has one personality. They are who they are. They don't show the multiple personality disorder, but their thinking seems disordered. Let's get into that a little bit more. Well, first of all, here, just to highlight this, prevalence in males and females. You see, we see schizophrenia in both. This is one case where I think it's a little more common in males than it is in females. If you look at age of onset, in the purple bars, you see that when it hits males, it tends to hit them relatively early, in their 20s or 30s. But it can strike at any time of life. So anybody could suddenly go from, you know, a normally functioning person to be showing some symptoms of schizophrenia. For females, again, it's also, there's a lot of schizophrenic women out there as well. It seems to onset a little later in life for females, but otherwise, you know, it's there. So, yeah. And these are people who've been hospitalized for schizophrenia, just to make that clear. So what are these symptoms? The symptoms tend to, first of all, be thought of as in two groups. Ones we're going to call positive symptoms and ones we're going to call negative symptoms. Now, we don't mean positive as in good. We mean positive as in the plus sign, sort of, in the sense that these are things that schizophrenics experience that people without schizophrenia do not. So these are things added, I guess, to their world. And then later we're going to talk about things that we show or experience that they don't. Those will be the negative. So let's be more clear, positive. One of the things, very, very common, perhaps the most common thing in schizophrenia, are auditory hallucinations, hearing voices, okay? We all have heard that claim before, that I hear voices in my head and they may be telling, sometimes they tell the schizophrenic patient to do something, so they're compelling them to do something. There's a great mind, by the way, a great movie, A Beautiful Mind. If you want to watch a movie that depicts schizophrenia pretty well, it's a true story. John Nash, famous mathematician. So it's very interesting, and they do some good film work to mess with your head while you're watching it. The one thing that's a little odd in that movie is that the lead character in that movie has a lot of visual hallucinations. Sometimes people with schizophrenia do have visual hallucinations, but predominantly they're auditory. So mostly they hear things in their mind. Okay. Now, let me just revisit something we talked about with respect to this. When I talked about what a balancing act it is to not have a mental health issue, consider the following. We all hear voices in our head, I think. I certainly hear voices in my head all the time. We might call them thoughts. We might call them, you know, we can have a discussion with somebody. Let's say I want to have a discussion with, I don't know. I want to have a discussion with Jim Morrison from The Doors, who, by the way, is dead, but that doesn't stop me. I can imagine me and Jim sitting down and talking, and I can actually hear the conversation if I do it right, and it is kind of in my head. Now, if somebody were speaking right beside me, it would be different, right? And this is the important thing, and we, the people without schizophrenia, are somehow good at telling the difference between things we're thinking and things that are really happening. And to give you a sense of how fine that balancing act, it can come down to something like Wernicke's area. So Wernicke's area is the part of our brain that decodes speech. And when you're talking to yourself in your head, it's active. So you are literally, your Broca's area is active, and your Wernicke's area is active. So it's like there is something in your mind that's speaking and something in your mind that's listening and decoding that. However, when it's an internal thought, that activity level is low. It's there, it's present, but it's low. If somebody speaks to you from the external world, we see a lot more activation in Wernicke's area. And that's what kind of tells you, oh, this came from the outside. So when you have that in mind, then all that has to go wrong sometimes for some schizophrenic patients is their Wernicke's area might be a little too active, almost like the amygdala was for panic disorder. So if your Wernicke's area is a little too active, then when you're thinking a conversation, if Wernicke's gets active enough, you will hear it as though it happened in the outside world. So suddenly it won't feel like you generated that. It felt like it came from somewhere else, right? Just like it does if someone starts talking behind me. I know someone's talking behind me. I can detect that wasn't a thought. That was a real person. So that's maybe part of the story of schizophrenia. That these voices, that Wernicke's area is being triggered and they're hearing these voices in their head. But because Wernicke's area is being triggered, the voices feel like not theirs. And that's the kind of weird thing. When I talk to Jim Morrison, I can talk to Jim Morrison in my head, but then I kind of own, I think that conversation is mine. I did that. But as soon as that Wernicke's area gets active, it's no longer mine. And now it becomes an external force speaking to me. And that's very powerful. Now, how do people cope with these auditory hallucinations, these voices that they're hearing? Well, very often, a number of things can happen that we're going to call delusions. So sometimes they can feel tortured by these voices and delusions of persecution. So the voices might always be saying why you're not a good person. You're not a worthy person. You won't get this job. You won't whatever. And so it's like this voice is constantly persecuting you all the time. And you might think everybody wants to persecute you. Or delusions of control. Some schizophrenics feel like that voice is an entity that has taken control over them. And so these voices actually compel them to do something. So they have delusion that they're under control of another entity. Other people have what we call delusions of grandeur, which was actually my first band name. I like that one. Delusions of grandeur is thinking that you're someone special. So, you know, if you think of this now, some people think these voices in their head are angels speaking to them, or are gods speaking to them, or are God speaking to them. And so some schizophrenics believe, for example, they are Jesus Christ. They are the next Jesus Christ, and they're in communication with God, and the rest of the world doesn't know it, but that's who I am. So that's what we call delusions of grandeur, because they now think they're a very important person. A powerful, relevant person. There's a lot of, if you go into some of these mental health institutes, you can find a lot of people who think they are famous, powerful people because that's what their voices tell them, whatnot. So these are things that schizophrenics, again, tend to, it's part of their world that isn't part of ours. The delusions of persecution also is like delusions of paranoia. That's often described there too, thinking everybody's out to get them. In a tricky world now, right, where everybody's got these, and if you walk around, you see somebody look up at you and then type in their phone, and if they have their phone like this, maybe they're taking a picture of you. You don't know, you know, who's taking pictures, so suddenly you're feeling like everyone's watching me, everyone's taking control of me, etc. Let me mention one other thing about this before we leave the positive symptoms. That distinction about is the voice in my head or is it in the outside world? Their trouble ranges a little further than just the sound of voices. It's more of a problem confusing thoughts with reality in general. And let me again say, this is something we all experience. I mean, I'm sure you all have had the experience where you go up to somebody and you say, man, there's something I want to tell you, but I kind of think I might have told you already, but I'm not sure. Okay, when you say that, you're saying, I know I wanted to tell you, I know I thought about telling you, but now I can't remember if that actually occurred in reality or if it only occurred in my mind. So you're kind of confused. Or you might say, you know, I thought I did something, but I only dreamed it. Did I only dream that or did that really happen? So when you're in that situation, again, you're trying to, is this a mental internal event or is this an external event? So with the schizophrenic, here's a classic kind of symptom of a paranoid schizophrenic. They might be driving home and they might see one of these Bell trucks working on the boxes in their neighborhood. And then they might a little while later see some guy that looked a little different to them walking by their house. And they have all these thoughts going on. Okay, that bell thing, that's FBI. They're trying to tap into my phones because everyone's watching me and everyone wants to know what I'm up to. They're all trying to get me. And so as I go home, oh, there's that guy, and that guy's working with the FBI. And I think he's the main dude in this conspiracy that's out to get me. And so they have all these thoughts. But again, I mean, we might kind of have fun having those thoughts. But the problem is, if you now ask them about it, these thoughts become reality to them. I know they're from the FBI. I saw the FBI badge on that guy, which they might have just sort of imagined an FBI badge, but they can't tell the difference between what they imagined and thought and what they really saw. It all feels real to them. And because of that, they can show this very crazy behavior of, running away or talking to people who aren't there, very common for schizophrenics, etc. All right. Positive symptoms. Let's go to the negative and then we'll kind of connect these up. Negative symptoms. So again, what we mean by negative is these are things that normal people do well, I guess, and these guys don't. So let's just do some and we'll have the example. Disorganized speech. I don't know if I could try to grab some of what's actually written behind that. I went to class today and my grandma was there and she was like, "Don't leave the toilet seat up. The parakeet could get a parking ticket." So I jumped down the catwalk and my gorilla fried tuba top yelled, "Shoop de whoop," and filled his loop. Anyway, so you get the idea. So this person is speaking in sentences that's grammatically correct, but what they're saying makes no sense. It's all messed up. And this is where I think schizophrenia, that sort of broken mind kind of thing, came from. And so the idea here is we have some ability of organizing our communication in a structured way that allows others to understand it. They seem to not have that ability. They seem to have lost that ability. And so they can seem like their thoughts make no sense. When you speak to them, some of them, what they will tell you is, "My thoughts go so fast." A lot of schizophrenics feel like their mind is just going, 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 going. And so they're trying to tell you stuff, but as they try to tell you something, they're already 5 steps ahead of where their mouth is. And so then they try to keep up and they're mixing all these things in there, and then you're sitting back there and saying, "I have no idea what you're talking about." But to them, it's because they almost their mouth can't keep up with their mind. And therefore what comes out of their mouth doesn't make sense. I'm gonna come back to that mind racing in a second. They tend to lack emotion or sometimes inappropriately use it. So they don't laugh when other people laugh. They don't cry when other people cry. Sometimes they cry when other people laugh. Sometimes they laugh at a funeral or something like that. So it's not totally a lack of emotion, although they do tend to be much more what we call a flat affect. They tend to be less high and less low. So there's not a lot of depressed schizophrenics, I don't think. They tend to be emotionally kind of flat. But when they do show emotion, it's often inappropriate too. It's not appropriate to the context. So they lack appropriate emotional regulation, and they generally show less emotion in general. They lack energy, very unmotivated. Different unmotivated than the depressed people. It's like a schizophrenic can just sit on the couch, smoke cigarettes, and watch TV all day and be good. And you wouldn't call them depressed because they don't tend to have that worthless, helpless negativity going through their head. They just are unmotivated. They just are happy to do nothing, and they can live that way. Socially inept, inability to make and keep friends. A lot of the homeless people that you see on the streets suffer from schizophrenia. And some of them, by the way, just have these negative symptoms. And so imagine you had no motivation to do anything other than to sit in one place. You can't get along with people anyway. When you speak, you make no sense, and your emotions are all messed up. This is why it's hard for these people to, "Hey, buddy, just get a job," right? When somebody sees someone on the street, "Why don't you just get a job?" Well, a lot of schizophrenics can't function in a work environment. And they wouldn't even go to the work environment anyway. So, yeah, sitting on a street with a hat, hanging out, that kind of works. It kind of works for them. So, keep that in mind, that a lot of the homeless people you meet, maybe suffering from schizophrenia. And by the way, the vast majority of them are not dangerous. I should touch on that. If we go back to the positive symptoms again, we hear about extreme cases. And an extreme case would go something like this. With these positive symptoms, this is what really feeds the potential dangerous activity. So they might say, I was told by God that I must do something, that I've been chosen to do something. You get a little bit of delusions of grandeur in here. And what that is there's a bunch of demons that have been released on the earth. And it's my job to purge the demons. And this has to be done. It's for the good of humanity. And I've been chosen by God to be the one to do that. And so, you know, a patient like this might go into some setting, whatever that might be, and could potentially even kill a bunch of people believing that they are doing a righteous act, believing that what they're doing is in fact good. Because the voice in their head tells them it's good and explains it to them. This is where we get into issues of people getting put into mental institutions instead of jails when they sometimes commit horrific acts, because the ultimate question we ask is, did they understand that what they were doing was horrible and bad and wrong? Did they know that? Did they get it? And some schizophrenic patients think they're actually doing good. When they're doing these horrific acts. But, I mean, we tell soldiers to do horrific acts all the time and we tell them it's good, right? So it's the same sort of mentality. The important point I want to make, though, is for most schizophrenic patients, you know, that extreme of somebody going in and shooting a bunch of people is very rare. And it's partly rare. I already told you why it's partly rare. That schizophrenics tend to be not very motivated. So that takes a lot of energy and planning and stuff, and not many schizophrenics have that sort of energy and desire. So on the most part, schizophrenia is a very prevalent disease, and it doesn't lead to a lot of danger, but it sometimes does. The persecution, sometimes people can feel like family members are out to get them, and I know one case where a person lit their house on fire with their parents sleeping because they thought their parents were in on something and it was the right thing to do again. So there can be danger. But what I want to point out here is, in fact, because of these negative symptoms, they don't tend to be very dangerous. They tend to just seem odd or unmotivated to us for the most part. All right. So what are these types of schizophrenia then? I'm going to talk about the types in two different senses here, and first we'll kind of go over here. The one you see depicted the most is the paranoid schizophrenic. And for the paranoid schizophrenic, those positive symptoms are really dominant. They're the ones that are really kind of at the forefront. And so they often have delusions of persecution where they think the world is out to get them. They're often intelligent. And their functioning is really good, but they have these auditory hallucinations and they have this trouble telling reality from stuff they thought up. And so they can do some really bizarre and sometimes dangerous acts because of that, because these positive symptoms are powerful and the negative ones not so much. Now, the good news about this, when we get into some of the therapies, the positive symptoms of schizophrenia can be controlled very well with some psychoactive drugs. So you can make them go away. The negative ones you can't control so well. But because these guys it's the positive symptoms that are dominant, then those drugs tend to help them a lot. And they can very quickly get back to a normal functioning state as long as they keep taking their meds, which we'll come back to. So that's the paranoid schizophrenic. Now for a disorganized schizophrenic, it's the negative symptoms that tend to be more common. And these are the people you tend to see on city streets, the disorganized schizophrenics. So they don't tend to have those delusions. You may see them speaking to somebody. They might still have auditory hallucinations, but they tend to be much more benign. It's more like, again, that they might be seeming to have a conversation and nobody's there. It's not like the voices are dominating them and taking control. Instead, they seem to have these cognitive problems that they, so these are the people maybe walking down the street, screaming something out as though it's the most important thing in the world. But what they're saying makes no sense. So they're very passionate about it, but it makes no sense whatsoever. And so that's, a disorganized schizophrenic, and those negative symptoms are really prominent. Their lack of emotionality and all that kind of stuff. These guys, we can't help so well. We can't get rid of those symptoms. And so, yeah, that is why, even if you had the positive and negative, we can treat the positive, but you still might end up being a kind of person who wants to just sit on the street. And is unmotivated to do much of anything. Right. There's a weird one. This next one, catatonic schizophrenia. I don't know where this fits into anything, and it's a strange, strange thing. People with catatonic schizophrenia will adopt weird poses, and they will become these weird plastic people. So they might be standing somewhere like this for hours on end, and just in that position. And if you go up and you physically move their hand, you can move their hand, and then they'll stand like this. And you can push their body over, and they'll stand like this. The catatonic implies immobile, sort of. And so that's what they show is this immobility that looks weird, or motor behaviors that look really weird. So it's all about their motor behaviors either being just bizarre or being catatonic, immobile. And adopting these immobile poses. What this has to do with any of the rest, wow, I don't know. And I think that shows you how difficult it is to categorize some of these disorders. We also have this undifferentiated, where we can't clearly put a person in any of these categories. So they may have some positive and some negative symptoms, but not clear which. Okay. So, in addition to that, think of the categories: paranoid, disorganized, those are the two big ones. Catatonic, that's the strange one, and then undifferentiated, we don't know. For each of those, we can now talk about this residual reactive or process type. So, a residual type is type, here it says type that follows one of the others but is marked only by negative symptoms. What this means is if we treat somebody, then again, as I mentioned, we can treat the positive symptoms, but they're still always going to have those negative ones. And so we would call that residual. That's the leftover. That's the stuff we can't get rid of. And so they may be in a residual type of schizophrenia. What that means, of course, is if they go off their meds, then the positive symptoms will come back. And they could go back to full-blown schizophrenia. And so we're able to control some of it, but they still have to deal with what's left, and we call that a residual. The reactive type of schizophrenia is a type that's almost always caused by stress. It's that stress diathesis kind of approach, and it tends to onset really rapidly. So somebody who's normally functioning and doing well, some major stressor enters into their life. And very quickly, they start showing schizophrenic-like symptoms. That we call reactive, and that's just one of the ways it onsets, but it's a very dramatic onset when it does that. Versus what we call a process schizophrenic, which is a type marked by gradual onset. So when you have this, the symptoms slowly start to appear and get worse and worse and worse over time, this is actually the worst kind. This is the kind we have the most trouble effectively dealing with. The reactive ones, because of the stress link, it seems like the person has a chance of getting back to a reasonably normal way of living. They will always have some residual, probably, effects from the schizophrenia, but if they can get through that stress period, then maybe they can do a little better. But the process type is just a gradual onset. You sometimes, by the way, hear weird things about drugs and schizophrenia. I'll mention a couple of them. There was certainly a case, a time when a lot of people thought drugs like LSD, when they were first discovered or invented, I guess, psychoactive drugs, that they induced schizophrenia. That when you took LSD, you essentially became a schizophrenic. Your mind starts racing 50 miles an hour, but you're not making any sense when you try to describe what's going on. It feels really powerful and important to you. Or maybe you're having hallucinations, etc. So there was people who played with hallucinogenics thinking first they might be like a model of schizophrenia. We might be able to make somebody temporarily schizophrenic. But then a lot of people claim, no, there's very clear differences between the two as well. Some people tried to use psychedelics to treat schizophrenia. That didn't work out very well. There is also the claim, though, by some people, that use of psychedelics might trigger schizophrenia. That if you are somebody with a schizophrenic predisposition and you started using some drug, that might actually trigger the schizophrenia. So you might have a bad trip or something, you know, you have one extreme psychedelic experience, but that shatters your mind somehow and you never come back. And so parents used to, you know, love to frighten their children with this to keep them off the psychoactive drugs. There was always a famous story, in fact, that the original lead singer of Pink Floyd, Sid Barrett, that he certainly became mentally unstable and was in a mental facility for a long time. The album The Wall is his bandmates kind of writing about Sid's progression, I guess, where he went. And Sid used to do a lot of LSD. And so people claim that it was the LSD that made him mentally unwell. However, anyone who looks into Sid's life realizes that he was a process schizophrenic. He showed symptoms before ever doing any psychedelics. You know, as a child and growing up, he had issues right from the get-go. He was able to be a musician despite those. He started using a ton of psychedelics, and there's no doubt things got worse from there. But that connection that the hallucinogenic causes schizophrenia or triggers it, there's not a lot of evidence for that either, but you'll see it kind of described on the internet and stuff. You'll see things like that. All right. What about genetics? There certainly seems to be a genetic link. When we look at the likelihood of somebody becoming schizophrenic or being categorized as schizophrenic as a function of whether their parents were or their children were or et cetera. So these pink ones are all close relatives, and you see different rates. And of course, the most extreme rate here is if your identical twin is schizophrenic, well, there's more than a half likelihood that you will show the same pattern sooner or later. Whoops, sorry. Notice here also, if both of your parents are schizophrenic, you're at about a 40% chance of being categorized as schizophrenic at some point. As you get further away, the effect is much, much smaller. But certainly there does seem as though there is this connection, a genetic connection that's underlying things. So this is, it's results like this that make us think of schizophrenia differently than, say, the mood disorders. The mood disorders, we're hopeful that with some cognitive strategy, we can train people to think differently and that'll make them feel better. With schizophrenia, it's more like a biological disease. And we tend to treat it with drugs only. You can't talk somebody out of schizophrenia. You can't train their mind to avoid some of these things. So this feels much more like a biological based kind of disorder. And so biological treatments are going to be more common. In fact, here's some of the hypotheses. We have drugs. Famous one used for a long time was chlorpromazine, which blocks what we call dopamine agonist receptors. And so you can use these drugs, and when you block these receptors, then you see less of the positive symptoms. And so the suggestion is that dopamine and levels of dopamine are part of what's at play here. This interesting other thing I mentioned is if you give people too much of this chlorpromazine, if you're blocking these receptors too much, so if you block the receptors, that reduces the effectiveness of dopamine, right? But if you reduce it too much, then you start to see immobility issues and muscular issues. In fact, you start to see like a Parkinson's like syndrome. So Parkinson's people often show the shakes, the shaky hands and such, but they also have this problem initiating action. So a Parkinson's person, if they stop at a road because it's the red hand, and then it goes to the white man, go ahead, they have trouble getting going. Sometimes they need a push, literally. A little bit of a push and that gets them going. Once they're walking, they're okay. So if we give a schizophrenic too much antipsychotic drugs, they start to seem to be like a Parkinson's patient. And it all seems to link to the amount of dopamine. So that's kind of interesting, I guess. The other thing we know, we have here amphetamine psychosis. If you take too much speed, too many amphetamines that kind of pump you up, amphetamines block the dopamine transporters, and so they raise the level of dopamine in the blood system. And if you have too much of that, you start to act very schizophrenic. And if you give a schizophrenic amphetamine, then they become a super schizophrenic. It blows the all the symptomology to a whole new level. So all of this suggests that dopamine is a key factor. It's at least correlated with the symptomology. And so biologically, a lot of the drugs are all working on this sort of dopamine symptom system. Here's part of the problem, though. When we look at the brain of a schizophrenic, we see these imbalances sort of all over the place. So this just shows different parts of the brain where we have seen abnormal functioning in schizophrenia. This was the one I was talking about. Overactivity of the speech area, Wernicke's area, can create these auditory hallucinations. So you think you hear something rather than thinking it. But you know, notice that for all of these, so some schizophrenics have full-blown visual hallucinations. So their occipital lobe can behave almost like the Wernicke's did, where we can imagine, I can do that thing to you again of imagine a house, how many windows does it have? A specific house, how many windows does it have? And we can kind of mentally see that. When they do it, it can feel real to them. They can cross that line between mental and actual again. And you know, as we go through, we see the hippocampus doesn't seem to work quite right for schizophrenic patients. There's disturbances in their limbic system, which are related to emotion and the sort of agitation, the sort of discomfort. Frontal lobes aren't working right. Basal ganglia aren't working right. So certainly, schizophrenic brains seem different. In terms of at least they're processing. So I'm not really talking about the brain, you know, looking different physically, but the way it reacts to stimuli seems very different. When we look at brain functioning, their brains function very differently than ours do. And a lot of these kind of make sense with some of the symptomology we see. So again, just kind of stressing, there's something biological going on here. So we talk about the genetic stuff. Does that mean environment doesn't matter at all? Well, no, environment almost always matters too. When we look at the what we call the etiology, the context that seems to spawn schizophrenia, if you look back at the family styles of people who develop schizophrenia, there seems to be a disproportionate number of families that utilize this sort of double bind kind of approach, which is kind of weird, which is what we would call sort of mixed signals. So it's kind of like when a parent really suggesting you should do something, you really should do X. I don't know. You should go out and get a job. That's what you really need to do. And if you went out and got a job, things would be better. And so you go out and get a job, and then so you're like, I got a job, and they don't seem all that excited by the fact that you got a job. And then maybe they're complaining. You're never around to help any, and you say, but I got a job, I have to work, you told me to get a job. Your job gets in the way of all these things. So suddenly, the thing that they were pressuring you to do, they're not rewarding you for having done it. In fact, they might actually be punishing you. So people who live in one of these sort of mixed signal families where they never can seem to do the right thing, even when they try to do what they think the person wants, that seems to be very common. Family situation for people who develop schizophrenia. What does that mean? I don't know. We do also know that expressed emotion, this is really important sometimes for relapse, that if we have a schizophrenic and we medicate them, to a point where their positive symptoms decrease, they're not hearing hallucinations, they're not having these delusions. We sometimes then release them back into the care of their family. And if we know there, if the family is high in what they call expressed emotion, if it's a very critical family, so they criticize things the person does, they're kind of hostile, they're emotionally too connected, they're kind of watching this person too closely and judging everything they do. If you live in a situation like that, or if a schizophrenic returns to a situation like that, they very often relapse. Okay, that kind of non-supportive, critical atmosphere seems to make the person more likely to relapse, and therefore might also be part of a situation that develops it. So these just to say, it's not just about the biology. The environment plays a role, both in terms of maybe whether this develops or not, but also in terms of helping somebody once they are getting treatment. The environment is very critical to their prognosis. End of show. Weird. All right. Stop there. All right, so these were in lieu of both Friday and Monday's class, and so we should be now up to speed. So the next class I will see you in is Wednesday, a week from today, which I guess would be the 22nd. And until then, enjoy. Later, guys.